On this week's episode of The Video Store, Frank and Josh decide if Hobbs and Shaw is ooh and aah. Frank brought Josh to Serenity staring at Matthew McConaughey's ass. And Josh takes a velvet buzzsaw to Frank's mind.
Swing away! Welcome to The Video Store Podcast. My name is Frank. I'm joined by a gentleman I am told is named...
Josh, I think.
Okay.
Yosh. Sometimes...
All right, calm down. Every week, we try to find you something to watch by reviewing everything we saw from the previous episode and tell you what's available to stream, download, watch on video on demand, or even go out to a movie theater. But first, we like to start our episodes with a little thoughts and trailers as curated by Josh.
I'm the curator.
Can't help yourself.
I can't.
He has three trailers, and they all look pretty interesting, starting with Vigilante. I'm sorry, A Vigilante.
Yeah, you better get that right. It's not The Vigilante either. Yeah.
Starring Olivia Wilde. This one's due out in March. Looks like it's probably going to be like a VOD limited release, but it's about a vigilante, as the title suggests, who specifically helps victims escape their domestic abusers. I like this trailer. I thought it looked very stylized. You know, it reminded me of the Nicole Kidman trailer.
Exactly, right?
Yeah, like Olivia Wilde, who's like America's Emily Blunt, because I always get them confused. Like, this is a good role for her. I think she sells it pretty well in the 2 minutes I watch.
Yeah, no, I think that it's interesting. We're seeing a lot more movies with this kind of like really rogue woman, powerful badass. Remember Peppermint, you know, I saw with Jennifer Garner. I think they're doing a good job with who they're picking for these roles. It just depends on how they produce it. Because in the same sense, you know, we look at like the Taken movies and things like that. And this is kind of shooting on the equality genre of that factor. But at least it doesn't seem displaced. And like you would just could never believe that that woman would put herself in that situation, but definitely seems intense and a little bit terrifying. So we'll see.
For sure. Yeah. I think it's a simple ingredient change. These are the type of movies we usually see, like Liam Neeson playing or someone else. And
give me back my family.
You put a woman in there and I'm not opposed to watching a badass woman. And then it probably expands the audience because you have a woman in there and it just looks like an interesting movie and very artsy. Up next, The Extremely Wicked, Shocking and Vile. This is the Ted Bundy story starring Zac Efron. It's at Sundance now. It looks like a movie that is about the obsession with serial killers during another peak time in American culture where we are all mostly obsessed with serial killers. Like true crime, true murder dominates podcasts. It dominates Netflix documentaries. It's a genre where I know people where majority of the entertainment they consume is related to serial killers.
Yeah, it's weird. I think, you know, coming from High School Musical to, you know, murdering women, this is an interesting choice for him. And I think they picked somebody that they purposely made so hard to not fall in love with kind of thing. They're like, we know this character has a ridiculously terrible past, but guess what? We're going to make it Zac Efron.
Yeah, well, Ted Bundy was known for his good looks, apparently. I try to be careful about supporting, like, the exploit of this stuff. I don't know. This movie, the trailer leaves a lot to find out. There's a lot of gray areas in the trailer. I don't know. It looks a little too cool and fun for the subject.
Right.
And that worries me. I don't think that's cool, man. But we'll see.
Yeah, murdering people is not cool. I mean, I like
Zodiac because it, you know,
yeah.
it didn't really put a face on the killer. It's about the process and these guys' obsession to try to solve this case.
Exactly.
It just looks like just a biopic, you know.
Yeah, it seems like Bohemian Rhapsody with murdering.
Yeah, that's say no more. The final trailer, the third and final trailer. Oh, and that movie, Extremely Wicked, Shocking and Vile, is TBA. It's in the film festival circuit right now. So I would assume we'll see it in theaters at some point before the end of the year. We will see in theaters this August the first of the Fast and the Furious spinoffs, Hobbs and Shaw.
Hobbs and Shaw.
I know you're not a huge fan of this stuff. I am, when it's done properly. I like a good buddy cop, stupid action comedy.
But they're not cops. One's a rogue agent.
Yeah, but it follows that formula. They're vigilantes. Yeah,
it felt like Lethal Weapon, like 17 by the end of it, for sure.
For sure. And yeah, like the weird thing is that Shaw like murdered like key members of the Fast and Furious family. But in the last movie, they just washed that all away. He got invited to the cookout.
They're over it. It's not a big deal. Hey, look, we're all people, right? So family.
Yeah. And this series is inevitably going to deal with space and or time travel at some point. It just keeps getting more ridiculous.
Now
and
that I look forward to. Yeah,
it's so self-aware, and the action scenes are really good typically in this stuff. And as I grow tired of The Rock, I still think this is one of his better roles and his more fun roles, because Jason Statham kind of pushes him. I feel like they worked well off each other in the last Fast and Furious movie. They were the highlight of it. So this makes sense.
Well, you know, there was like a big fallout, I guess, between the Fast and Furious crew. I think Tyrese and some shit and The Rock had some beef.
It's all stems from Vin Diesel and The Rock having beef. Yeah, they have.
Yeah, something.
Yeah, there's a power struggle there. So The Rock's going to get these movies, and then he's not going to be involved in the Fast and Furious like title movies. Like the Fast and Furious proper is going to be Vin Diesel and the boys. So. Yeah,
interesting.
I mean, it's whatever. It's kind of silly. I'm not going to pick a side because, you know, they're all just
Team
like,
Diesel.
Yeah, it's just silly. But I'm looking forward to that, and that will be on August. I'm 100% going to see that one.
Okay. Yeah, I'm up in the air.
All right. Next up, the second part of the segment, we talk about what we watched. We do some short reviews. Will remain spoiler free until we warn you. First off, I'm going to say that I'm going to hold off on saying much about The Standoff at Sparrow Creek, which is available on rental and VOD now, because Josh is going to watch that, and we'll do like a spoiler-ish episode next week. So if you want to watch it in preparation for that, I will highly recommend this movie. I've not seen a lot this year, but it is my favorite movie of 2019 so far. So it's an employee pick, but we'll get into it more next week. Yeah. On to things we can talk about. I still watching old movies. It's just
I really don't get your gasm at the moment. I'm not really sure what's ticking your tuck.
So this first one, Four Weddings and a Funeral, is a mid-90s romantic comedy that kind of sprung Hugh Grant onto American audiences.
What a terrible idea that was, huh?
I watched this last Sunday morning, and it was I was just in the mood for a comedy. There's not a lot of good comedies that have been out that I haven't seen, so I had to go way back to 94. I thought this was really good. It's an employee pick. Even if you're not a huge fan of the romantic comedy genre, I think it's one of the best of them. And it's worked so well because everything's grounded in reality. It took me a while to be convinced that Hugh Grant like had to work to pick up women. Like I know of him as this charming guy from, you know, all his roles after this. So it was hard to like really believe him as like the everyman, but eventually that went away. The friends are really accurate. The friendship, it's a bunch of like late 20s people that are just hooking up and not really, you know, adulting yet, and they just go through all these weddings, you know, as it says, four weddings and a funeral, and they're trying to figure out their life romantically. And I thought it was very accurate and definitely opened some wounds for me. Like I could relate to these characters. It's funny, it's charming, and the romance stuff works. Andy McDowell's great in this, as the girl that, you know, Hugh Grant pines after. And then also Kristen Scott Thomas was a really good tragic character that had a good story arc as well. So I will recommend this one.
Okay. All right. I saw it a long time ago, and I don't really have too much on it. I just remember her ridiculous hat.
Yeah, her hat is ridiculous, but she pulls it off.
Yeah, that's fair.
Yeah. Another like classic film I checked off my box. And that one was on Amazon Prime, by the way. Checked off my box of things, yeah. Akira. Have you seen Akira? 1988 anime?
I feel like yes.
Okay. Stunning considering that this thing is 30 years old. It's about a secret military project that endangers Neo Tokyo when it turns a biker gang member into a rampaging psychic psychopath that only two teenagers and a group of psychics can hope to stop. So this is a sci-fi movie that is like a response to the atomic bomb and like just, you know, rebuilding your civilization. And then what if it happened again? You know, the storytelling everything is like pushed to its limits because technically, like, this thing is so ahead of its time and looks amazing, and it's a very ambitious story. It was choppy at times. I don't know if that's like a cultural thing where I'm used to like the beats of an American movie. But despite that, man, this one's like really smart and just really fucking weird and too weird for me not to love. And just science fiction by the way of trying to understand a horrific event and also paint like a dystopian future. So going to highly recommend that one as well if you haven't seen it. I checked that out on Hulu. But if you got to rent it, you know, it's worth a couple bucks. I'll say that. Plowing along, I am interested to hear about your review in a few moments about The Kid Who Would Be King, Josh. But I saw the first film, rewatched by Joe Cornish's first movie, and it's called Attack the Block. I know you're a fan of this, right?
Yeah, no, it was super fun watch.
Yeah, this was in the height of our, or towards the end of our video store careers, late 2011. Yeah, this
maybe
is like,
mine sooner than yours.
Yeah, yeah, that's true. You did get outed before me. This is like one of those fun one crazy night movies. I'll read the plot summary real quick. This one's about a teen gang in grim South London housing estate that teams up with other residents, including a woman that they robbed in the beginning of the movie, to protect their neighborhood from a terrifying alien invasion. It's action comedy with some sci-fi. I felt like the journey for redemption with the heroes felt natural because of their circumstances. Mm-hmm. I think the situation, like, those kids had to grow up and face the fact that they're kind of shitty and the fact that they meant so much to each other. Like, the characters, you get them right away and, you know, their bond and also, like, them coming from this poor neighborhood, but it's all they have. And I thought that was really smart and maybe, you know, gave them the story more meaning than your typical action comedy. And, John Boyega, young John Boyega stars in this, and you kind of see that, he's a future star. Although I thought all the kids were really good.
Yeah, and Nick Frost was great.
Well, yeah, the creatures looked pretty cool. I don't know if you're a fan of the black fuzzballs with the neon.
Yeah, no, I dug it. It was interesting at first because it almost seemed like they almost had no interaction with their environment to an extent that they were so displaced. But then as they destroy and rip apart people and things, you really find that they're just as terrifying as, you know, any other real creature that you would find. And I think it was done and stylized quite well, and just kind of left this really fuzzy alien invasion, humans versus the evil kind of situation going.
And you believe, because you watch those kids like navigate around the city and avoid cops and stuff, that they could have a chance with this, like, you know, this
extraterrestrial
threat. Like, they use their home field advantage.
Right, and how they kind of chase down the first one that they find and get real, like, that was, I thought, one of the more hilarious parts, where they're just like, you would think most people would be like, oh, fuck, run. And these kids are just like, let's chase it down and murder it, because they're just such little badass little English kids from the hood.
They're too naive to be scared. Like, they don't get it at first, but then, yeah,
pretty much,
then they realize the stakes at some point. But yeah, it's really good. It definitely has more heart and a better story than most of these like creature feature type movies are. So just a really good movie that holds up. And
can I just say that the song that the fucking bad guy was playing for everyone was like one of the worst things you'd ever hear. I mean, it was done on purpose, but remember, there was like that clack, clack, clack. There's some shit, or I don't know.
The
it was
dealer.
So. Yeah. Where he just kept making everyone listen to his terrible music.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, some good social commentary in there too. I watched it on Blu-ray because I thought it was good enough to own, and I think it's good enough to keep. It's available for rent or to purchase digitally, but or probably can pick up the Blu-ray for under $10. It's well worth checking out if you just like those fun one crazy night movies. And it's like kind of Edgar Wright adjacent, because Joe Cornish like worked on Edgar Wright's movies. You can see some of the influence there.
Yeah, definitely light, quippy, very, you know, quick humor with some good visual tones to it. But definitely a dual employee pick.
Yep. So, Idiocracy, Josh, when's the last time you saw Idiocracy?
Probably when Trump got elected, just to confirm.
So, that kind of like goes into my point, and I upset some of my friends when I said Idiocracy works better as a meme than a movie. I'm not saying it's bad. I think
it's not a great movie.
It's okay. It has its moments. To me, and it's available on rental VOD. I watched my DVD version of it because I've had it. I don't know if I need to keep this movie anymore. I don't know if I'll glim Like,
and yeah, I'm surprised you kind of own it, because that was the thing. I kind of was maybe one to at most two watches for me.
It's hard.
But
to
coming from Mike Judge, we all thought it was going to be something super amazing because he had been, you know, underground for a while. And we're like, oh, Mike Judge had fucking worked on this. We're, you know, we have to assume it's going to be great. And it was just, it was okay. And it's weird because it had all these great visuals and all this stuff. It just,
it's a great idea. It's it, the yeah. idea is so broad that you're, when you heard about it, if you're like me, I'm like, man, this could be great, because Mike Judge did a great job of dissecting office jobs, and in a way where, you know, Office Space, I didn't have an office job at that point in my life to
draw from, either.
But it was so relatable because he just nailed the dynamic between boss and employee and all that. So like, I was super excited for this movie, and it kind of ends up being just like an okay Futurama episode in live action. Like, you know, you have, and it came out around the same time as Futurama.
Wait a second.
Yeah, Futurama just nails it. So I think it's okay. It's a take it or leave it for me, which might shock some people because it's kind of grown cult status through the memes and through the comparison to current American political landscape and how we are.
Yeah, President Camacho.
Intellectuals.
Kalunga, whatever. Yeah. Terry Crews' fucking character was, which was so fucking great and amazing. And just the, we put Mountain Dew in the ground, but it's not growing anything. Like,
yeah,
it's got electrolytes.
He's a good character, but like, the social commentary is kind of like lowbrow and like just easy stuff.
Yeah. I think Luke Wilson might have been the first thing to go wrong with this movie, and nothing against Luke Wilson, but it just seemed like he was the most, you know, for somebody that's, I get they were supposed to have somebody play like the dumb, pretty
the
stupid
average guy, yeah,
right. And I just felt like it wasn't for him. I don't know. I think he might have set the tone for me to think this was not good. But just everything fell kind of flat, but was still like visually looking great. And all these great little concepts. It was definitely just a great conceptual piece that didn't hit everyone's funny bone. It just kind of has that, wow, this is a real dramatized world of what we could be.
Yeah, just okay for me. Not that funny and not that smart considering who it came from. Surprisingly.
Right, I was in the same boat. So don't, you know, don't think, don't let people
great.
Turn you
they'll,
on
they'll
there.
They'll hate both of
bullshit.
Us. They'll hate the whole podcast now.
That's fine.
Got it. Come at
Get away.
Come at Mike Judge, man. You can't miss. I'm almost done my Shyamalan-a-thon. I watched Signs on Blu-ray, which was one of my favorite Shyamalan movies at the point of seeing it. And I still think this movie really holds up. It's available for rental VOD. No one's streaming it for free currently. But, you know, Shyamalan's like usually shamelessly optimistic, and he is definitely in this movie. It's all about faith. It's all about dreamers. I thought it was really clever at the time to do this end of the world movie, which was a very popular genre, in a closed, you know, family setting. You had four main characters. You see some other people, but 99% of the movie is inhabited by them. And I thought the kids were really good. I thought, you know, Mel Gibson's character, former preacher who had, you know, lost someone and his faith is tested. We've seen that before, but I thought he added a lot to that, you know, that archetype. And Joaquin Phoenix, who probably playing one of his least complicated characters of his career, because it was early on, I thought he added a lot to like that bro-ish like jock character.
I love when he's wearing the hat.
Yeah, like all the character growth in this is really good, and something you usually don't see in that type of genre of film. And I think he almost, like, M. Night Shyamalan almost deliberately eggs on the cynics. You know, like, people were complaining, well, you know, if the aliens are allergic to water, why would they come here? Kind of missing the whole point that they were just, like,
they didn't know.
Yeah.
They're fallible.
They're right. Also just, you know, they're trying to take the humans. They were just trying to, you know, farm them.
Well, you know, I saw this in theaters, and I would agree this is on one of the better echelon of Shyamalan movies.
Yeah, because it's funny at times. Like, the drama works.
It was so intense.
And it's scary and thrilling, man. All those alien scenes work. Like, do you remember the scene where they're in the basement and they're looking for the mineshaft and the young boy's like, what? And then the alien arm comes out and grabs him?
Yeah, no, it was ridiculous.
Scary. And then
no, it was terrifying. Yeah. It had really good horror aspects to it. And I really think Mel Gibson, this was one of his better emotionally driven roles that he really made you feel his internal struggle with his battle for religion versus the horror that had befallen him.
Right? Yeah, because at first blush, you're like, this guy's just an asshole. But then you realize, like, he's trying to keep his family together, and he's having a hard time not freaking out. And so he's trying to stay strong for his children, and he's struggling with that, as you would. So, yeah, it's a really good movie. I think it holds up. I agree.
I think that's something worth a rewatch for me, maybe. You know, it's hard to get me to rewatch a Shyamalan. That'd be one, because it didn't feel as based in – it felt like a separate world from some of the stuff that he creates.
Yeah, it still has a lot of his, like, signature stuff in it, signature themes. But, yeah.
Yeah, where he shows up like an asshole.
He does show up like an asshole. But, yeah, he's just – I love that he's, and especially now in the point where his movies are self-financed, he does what he wants. And I think he fully understands what you want out of his movies, because he kind of fucks with you and, like, hints at that stuff, but then just does his own thing. And I appreciate that. In a world where Disney owns everything, like,
in a world where Disney owns everything,
it's cool to have guys like M. Night Shyamalan and Quentin Tarantino that could just do whatever.
Right. That still exist in a movie world, but aren't confined to the movie walls.
Yep. My final solo review of the week is going to be A Star Is Born, because there wasn't shit in theaters, and it was like literally, I was going to do the Kid Who Would Be King, and then it was like, do I see Bohemian Rhapsody just so I can have an opinion on
what
it,
because it's
going to be nominated. You watched it, and you said it was bad.
You should just, like, watch The Kid Who Would Be King.
And I was like, well, Josh already said that, and I was like, A Star Is Born, I want to check it out. I like Bradley Cooper. I like Lady Gaga the person more than her music. I just, like, you know, she's another person that does whatever the fuck she wants, and that's cool. Like, she's not, you know, doesn't really follow the studio mold. So what this breaks down to, movie's been done 4 times. It's a very familiar path for, like, a romance movie. Bradley Cooper's a musician. He discovers, you know, Lady Gaga's character doing a performance at, like, a dive drag bar. Yeah. And, you know, he falls in love with her, and he pumps her up and, you know, becomes jealous, blah, blah, blah.
There's some really good pun for sex?
They have sex.
Well, you said he pumps her up.
He gives her confidence and, like, and, like, builds her up, and she becomes huge, and then he becomes jealous of that. Everything is really good in the first half of the movie. The chemistry between those two, great. Like, and it's really working as a romantic comedy. And then the story just kind of turns mostly in about Cooper's character, Jack, and it kind of dulled the effectiveness of, like, the finale of the movie for me. It's just obsessed with him. He's a guy that struggles with alcohol addiction and pill addiction and, like, his journey. But she kind of just goes in the background, and it just leans too heavy in his character. And you get disconnected with Gaga's character, in my opinion, at the end, where, like, it's supposed to be about her, I think, like, A Star Is Born.
It was like, with your main star and your co-star, who is now your main star?
Yeah. So it all boils down to another take it or leave it. If you're a fan, if you know, you already saw this movie, probably, if you're a fan of Lady Gaga or this genre, if you like musical or, you know, and or romantic comedies, this stuff, this is good. Like, classic Hollywood romance story. It follows the mold. The performances are really good. I just didn't like the direction the film went. And then there's some good cameos for comedians, like Dave Chappelle, Dice Clay, and shit like that. I thought that was neat. So, yeah, that's the Star Is Born. Take it away.
Okay. I think I'm going to leave it, Frank. Yeah. No personal thing against your ability to go and watch this, but I just – yeah.
We have a review on the books. Did it for the
pod. All right. So that's fair. That's fair. I will always never negate you for doing it for the pod.
Yeah.
So the next up is something I had some time for. It's Polar. It is out now on Netflix, and it is about the world's top assassin, Duncan Vizsla, settling into retirement when his former employer marks him as a liability to the firm. So I just watched this mainly for Mads Mikkelsen, who I think – like, to me, this kind of looked like – a new installment of the Snake Plissken series. So that was a big thing for me, because you see him.
An eye patch.
Right. He's got the eye patch. He's got the hair. He's got the jacket. No, he's got everything going for him, saying, like, this is Snake Plissken. So recoming. So that was kind of what sold me on watching this. And I definitely got, I think, what I wanted from it. It was a good, really ridiculously action man versus the world storyline, where he is just two steps ahead and too quick for other motherfuckers, man. And he definitely kills it in this. And I think the storyline has a nice little light twist in it that adds to some unknown element that they kind of prolong throughout the storyline. Mm-hmm. But if you loved Snake Plissken and Escape from Anything, watch this movie, and I feel like it's another rendition of that. So you're going to get what I think you want if you've seen the trailer of this. So I think it's definitely a good watch.
I mean, I know some people will be offended that it even like encroaches on that beloved character of Snake Plissken.
But he does his own. No, absolutely.
They are remaking Escape from New York.
Are they?
So, yeah. It's
dumb. Really?
Dumb.
With who?
I don't know if that's been announced, but
well, so why not bring back Kurt? Yeah, no, I enjoyed it. It was cold. It falls into those Taken categories, but I think his acting was a little bit stepped up, and he has this really cold, disjointed role, and he has some internal struggle from being the hitman and he was put in a situation where poor information was given, and he ended up, you know, killing some people he didn't mean to kill, and it kind of like is an internal struggle for him while he has kind of forced out of that retirement thing. But Mads Mikkelsen, something I think I'd like to watch more of his movies for sure.
Sounds like you're a big fan of his. Now, did the movie look cool? Because it's directed by Jonas Åkerlund, who's like a prolific music video guy, but he also did Spun way back in 2002, which had like a lot of crazy cuts and edits to it.
Yeah, that shit was insane. That's maybe a reason why I kind of enjoyed the watch. It is visually pleasing, and it has just a great, colorful, captivating feel to it. So I think it's definitely something, if you're just looking for a popcorn flick, throw this sucker on. You'll enjoy it.
Okay, man. Good shit. And then you theater shamed me, because when I was going Gaga and Bradley Cooper, you were watching The Kid Who Would Be King, the follow-up, the long due follow-up, from Joe Cornish, director of Attack the Block.
Yeah, so this one's about a band of kids embark on an epic quest to thwart a medieval menace. It follows under the storyline of King Arthur, and that's kind of the book that was given to him by his mom. And it follows kind of, these are things that are like the book that are happening to us now, and how we're tying these two stories together. First off, this almost fell in a wishy-washy category for me, but by the end, I felt like, I'm not going to let my personal bias placate this movie. I think this is definitely a fun family adventure flick with endearing characters. That some of these movies, like the Perseus Jackson and some of these other ones that try and make you care about a whole fantasy world of characters, it's sometimes hard to just jump right into that. Mm-hmm. They do an okay job of that integration. So initially, the character Merlin shows up, and he's like this young 17-year-old kid, and he puts himself into the school to find Arthur, and he introduces himself as like Merton, and it's just ridiculous.
That's dumb. Yeah.
There's a lot of extra silliness that kind of initially had me on the fence with this one. But as the characters developed and the storyline pushed further, and the epic battle scene, I would say for the finality of it, was really enjoyable. I think that it was done really well and fun. And kind of how they enlist the help of their classmates and things like that. So it still has that good British humor in points. An interesting follow-up for him. And I think with what he was capable of doing on the lower end of graphics and CGI with Attack the Block, that this holds more of an epic placement and done quite well. So I don't know if you knew this, but Patrick Stewart is Merlin as well as this kid. He basically is going through Benjamin Button's disease, and he says as he gets older, he gets extremely younger, but he still reverts back to that version to like prove he's serious when like people weren't believing him. So throughout the movie, he kind of interchanges, and he does that by sneezing, which is hilarious. But Patrick Stewart is fucking great. You definitely want to check it out, if anything, just for his role there. But I'm not sure who the lady is who plays the evil Morgana, Rebecca Ferguson. Mm-hmm. I didn't feel so much from the evil adversary side of things that was impressive. It was really just the band of the cast and the heroicness that they performed with some complimentary things from Patrick Stewart. But they could have a better adversary, basically, would have sold me a little bit more on this.
Cool. But I mean, sounds like you had fun with it. And if you're cynical, ask Ken, then if you're a
it was hard at first.
Movie dad or movie mom, then you did something fun, right?
Yeah, I don't know what those hashtags mean, but yeah, I would agree. It's something fun that I think definitely a family watch that they would all enjoy going to the theaters. And that's really, I was trying to understand that, like, not every movie was directly meant for me, but can I still appreciate it? And I was on the fence at points because there is a little bit of low tone, but overall, awesome.
Cool. All right, man, that's a good pick. And maybe I'll see that if it's still in theaters. We're going to dip into spoiler territories for about the next 5 minutes or so, because we both watched The Mess, starring Matthew McConaughey and Anne Hathaway, that is Serenity.
The Messenity.
Here's my review on Letterboxd.
Wait, before you do your review, I'm sorry, can I just to let you know that I watched this movie with no trailer or information provided and went into it like 30 minutes in, like, is this a dumb fucking fisherman movie that Frank made me watch? Like, I want to stab him right now.
That's beautiful. I mean, even if you saw the trailer, you have no idea what's in store for you.
Yeah, but I think it sets the tone for that, where if you have no idea, you're just thinking you're watching like a dumbass Perfect Storm or some shit.
There's three phases of this movie for me, and I saw the trailer. First third of the movie, I was like, is this a fucking fishing movie? What? They're really leaning into this whole fishing story hard and heavy.
I like the fish.
Then second third of the movie, I'm like, oh, okay, this is the sleazy thriller that I signed up for. Like, Anne Hathaway
right.
shows
this is,
up.
This is the fucking Sharon Stone shit right here.
Yeah, this is like mid-90s sleazeball shit that
right.
feels all too familiar.
And you know, kill my husband and I'll fuck you.
And then the final third of the movie, spoiler. And then the drive home. With, you know, my thoughts, I think I'm going to need to see a therapist was my final.
Here's my final thoughts. Inception, a dream beyond a dream in another reality about a man in a dream.
So, yeah, this movie, Matthew McConaughey is a fisherman. Right? This movie is loaded with a bunch of great characters. He's as ex-wife Anne Hathaway, eventually, after he's sold, you know, he has this 30-minute fucking fishing story going on.
You know, Frank, you should probably go catch that fish and stop doing this podcast.
Yeah, I should go catch that fish. She shows up and reveals that her husband, played by Jason Clarke, is abusing
asshole.
Her. And her son, who he, you know, their son, Matthew McConaughey's, and her son, and she needs him to kill this guy, and she's going to give him $10 million. Jim and Hansu is like Matthew McConaughey's right-hand man, and he's religious. And his resolution to this, to prevent Matthew McConaughey from killing this guy, is to hire some kids to beat the shit out of this guy.
Yeah, so this makes sense.
Yeah.
And stab him in the hand, because this all... Okay, the believability stopped with me when you telling me that Anne Hathaway left Matthew McConaughey for this fucking asshole. No.
He came back from the war, man. He came back from the war. His head was all fucked up. And then there's Diane Lane's character, who just exists to pay Matthew McConaughey for sex so he can have more money to buy fishing supplies.
Hooker without hooks.
Yeah. And none of these characters are not – there's not much depth to them. There's also a lot
but
of violence and like strong sex scenes, and you find out with about 30 minutes to go that the whole thing is in the mind of a like 10-year-old.
Yeah. Okay. He dropped the bomb, everyone. Yeah. It's done. Bomb has just been dropped. It's all a fucking game.
It's a video game, but that doesn't make sense because it doesn't play like the kid's controlling Matthew McConaughey. He's like a self-aware AI.
That's kind of like Black Mirror-esque, where they have this like conscience like they did in the Space Fleet episode, where they're in a game, but there's a certain consciousness to the characters which I still never got that. I would be like, why would these characters have consciousness? You got to take that leap a little bit. I just love the introduction of the guy of the rules. Right.
Like, that's the thing.
Right. I really wanted him to start doing that song from Always Sunny, you know, what are the rules? What are the rules? Just introduce them that way. I don't know, dude. It was interesting, and I can care. I totally get the son's displacement and why he would do what he's doing.
In real life, his stepfather is abusing him, apparently, and his mother. But and then this creation of the game and his father's AI character who he communicates with, and halfway through the film you feel like there's some cosmic connection because you think they're both real people. There's that scene with the water where the water's vibrating on both ends.
And weird, why are you swimming naked with your son?
His brother, yeah, his son programs a lot of naked swimming with his dad. That's like just like the tip of the disturbing iceberg that is this kid's fucking mind. Like, it's basically the stereotypical video games ruin children's minds, like Grand Theft Auto playing kid. Like, he has such a fucked up view of everything. But this game motivates him to actually murder his stepfather, because that plays off in the background of the game.
Yeah, well, he changed the rules, basically. So now the rule is no longer that the fisherman's got to catch the fish, mm-hmm. that the fisherman's got to kill the guy. And, you know, the first thing that tipped me off to any of this was the size of that fucking fish when they brought him up for the first time. I was like, oh, that seems really unbelievable size fish. And that was the only thing. That was a little weird to me. But, yeah, I don't know that. So I'm still a little confused on the aspect that did the kid program Digimon Bisou to hire Argentinian.
Yeah.
I'm so bad.
Yeah, you're pulling a Frank right now.
I am.
It's okay. But so you can fuck yourself up asking questions, trying to make sense of this movie. Why does he like hate his mom? Like, she's a fucking like awful character in this game. And yeah, why are they having graphic sex? Like, why is that programmed? Like, and then his father, Matthew McConaughey, fucks her and he's like, I win. Like, that's the kid's view of the world. His dad comes back and fucks his mom and he wins over his stepdad. Like, it's a warped fucking mind. And I think they could have played into that a little bit better. Like, maybe there's something there. I don't want to get inside the head of a fucking disturbed 10-year-old though. Like, I'm not signing up for that.
Yeah, I'm probably good on that. Yeah.
So, I mean, it's an ill-advised idea. I enjoyed the crowd that I was with was mostly middle-aged women that I think were there for Matthew McConaughey and for, like, they wanted this.
And Anne Hathaway, right. They wanted the fucking Sharon Stone shit. And then when he got to they left
the
problem.
Ball, dude. When they dropped the ball, this is a video game. Like, the whole theater is just, like, quiet. Like, just, like, dead quiet. Like, it's just fucking
killer. I would have done that laugh right in the middle of the theater at that point when they just, like, it's all a game.
It's
suckers.
Wallace in the house.
He's laughing too.
Yeah. It's someone trying to be clever, and it's just not clever. It's just fucked up. And it's a video game movie from someone who seems to have never played video games. Okay. So that was a rowdy ending to that review. We are on the third and final segment, Josh. This is the WTWTW.
TW!
What to watch this week. Netflix.
Which some of us did.
We're going to talk. We're going to slide right into another review. Velvet Buzzsaw.
We're going to buzz right into it.
Please don't do that.
Hey.
Velvet Buzzsaw came out. It's the plot summary is, after a series of paintings by an unknown artist are discovered, a supernatural force enacts revenge on those who have allowed their greed to get in the way of the art. This is the writer-director of, Nightcrawler. Yeah. And the trailer looked really good. It's loaded with a bunch of people that I like, including Jake Gyllenhaal being reunited, as well as Rene Russo.
And it feels so good.
So tell me your thoughts on the movie first. I'll let you go first on this one.
Well, man, I will say that first off, everyone has a ridiculous name.
Yeah.
Are you telling me people just, like, if you name your kid that they're just going to magically grow up into that art world?
I don't know.
A little bit. Rodora? Rodora! Is that really? Come on. Anyways, to get on to the movie part of it, I think Jake Gyllenhaal plays this really twisted, almost like on a baseline of a Yelp reviewer that can destroy anyone. But he posts his own articulate, ridiculous reviews, and he's basically the word of God to any buyer or person in the market listening to advice about what to think of a piece. And that was another thing, is just how people were so easy. We all kind of had that concept and have an idea that smug, ridiculous people could look at anything and say that it's art. I don't know if you saw that Sacha Baron Cohen, the This Is America show, but he does a perfect episode with an artist lady that is ridiculous. The concept that you can just, like, my favorite scene being where the guy walks into Malkovich's space and he's looking at three bags of trash and he's like, this is beautiful. And it's like, that's trash. And it's like, yeah, no, that's exactly my point, that you're just pander. People, like, everyone in that world almost doesn't develop their own unique opinion as much as they want to flock to someone else's who's going to be bold, and that's Jake Gyllenhaal's character. So beyond that, I think I really didn't like the Josephina character. I thought she was kind of a bitch. And then my homeboy David Diggs shows up and he plays this great, you know, young prodigy street artist that's being brought into this world. And just kind of a little bit of a rogue, independent thinker. And I kind of liked how he played his role. It wasn't too much, but he was there and you felt like he was powerful in what he had to say in his moments. Let's switch it up. What are your initial thoughts on this?
Okay, I mean, I can summarize this pretty briefly. I liked the premise and the story in the beginning. That's what got me excited for this. This is like the first movie this year I was really excited for. I think Jake Gyllenhaal was fully committed to the role, and there were some great moments because of that. I think I was routinely pulled away from the story because, really, after every couple scenes, because it felt episodic and it was directed like an episodic way and it looked and felt like a TV show to me. And I think it's interesting that a movie that criticizes art just didn't feel like a film. And it's from a guy who made Nightcrawler, which I thought felt very cinematic. Perfect. And did things that you can only do in a movie. Like, I worry that some of these Netflix shows feel too similar and are kind of neutered in a way where they just kind of don't really quite look like TV. They just look like a Netflix movie, and that's not cool.
Kind of like House of Cards, in a sense.
I didn't watch House of Cards, but it's just familiar feeling for a lot of in-house Netflix stuff. And it also was so interested in following around its characters and its crowded cast. And
it didn't apply to the main storyline.
Yeah, it wanders away from the plot, yeah. And then it shifts the tone because of this from horror to comedy to romantic drama.
To more of a slasher, almost.
Yeah, and it was clunky, though. Like, it just didn't work. Because I thought it was just trying to do too much and like too obsessed with the characters. It's kind of like a slasher.
You know? Yeah, maybe they were just thinking that they could just set Jake Gyllenhaal loose and maybe he'll carry this one out. But you got to understand that you have to have the right complementary storyline for him to produce. And I think, yeah, he did everything he could and he was very watchable in this. But I would agree that I felt left unsatisfied to an extent and just a little unexplained, and not like the good kind of questions that we have sometimes, more just like you probably should have given us a little bit more on this and not as much about these dumb characters, especially if you're just going to tear them away at any second with minimal reason and or clue. It kind of just became, yeah, a bit of a slasher with that that entity coming and killing everyone. You know, I won't go as far as Slender Man because Jake Gyllenhaal's in it, but I feel it definitely is underperforming for what they could have gotten done.
Yeah,
here.
Yeah. And this type of disappointment, like, I'm going to say this is a don't do it. I think you want to avoid this movie.
I think people should still watch it for the conversation to see what, you know, other people think.
Fair. But the way this one let me down is different than, like, Serenity. And this is probably technically a better movie. It's definitely, there's more talent in Velvet Buzzsaw, but Serenity like falls apart in a glorious way where it's just like, I'm laughing at it. It's a piece of shit. But this one just kind of bummed me out. Like,
and a waste of Malkovich as well.
A waste of a lot of good people. You know, you have Toni Collette there, Rene Russo. And
I feel like Toni Collette did pretty good, though. I feel like she kind of owned that little sneaky, snidey, I'm going to be a little slithery snake.
Like I said, I like the performances. It was just like the tone of the movie just didn't work.
Yeah, I would agree. I could have watched maybe 2.5 hours more that maybe explained more of why, you know, what happened to all those people. Did they all become different parts of the art, or that anyone who had touched it before? Yeah, it just kind of, it got away from what it needed to talk about, for sure. Yeah, man, and talk more about these relationships that we gave no fucks about.
For sure. It would have worked better as like a limited series. It kind of wanted to be stretched out that way, in my opinion.
Yeah, I would agree.
So
take also, it or leave it. That's fair.
Yeah, I would say don't do it. Josh says take it or leave it. But I feel like you, if you're interested in this movie, you're not going to listen to us. You're going to find out on your own, because I heard similar stuff and I was like, these people got to get it wrong. It's probably just too weird for them, but no, it's not why I didn't like it.
Yeah. The ending was terrible too.
That's like not really memorable at all for me.
Nah.
Also Netflix, Ray Romano has a stand-up special called Right Here Around the Corner. It's his first stand-up special in a long time, and I'm curious. I'm a huge fan of stand-up, and not necessarily a huge Ray Romano fan, but it's been a while. I want to see why he's coming out with a one-hour special. My favorite reality show on Netflix has nailed it. I don't think you've watched this yet, Josh. It's about like baking fails.
No.
Hosted by Nicole Byer, really funny comedian, and a expert French chef who is hysterical. They play off each other so well.
Is it weird that I have a problem when titles use exclamation points? No. Like, stick it.
Yeah, so this new season is it's Nailed in Mexico, and it's just a real fun.
Sounds like a porn.
Calm down. But yeah, it's just a lighthearted, fun show. It's a feel-good show. Whenever my girlfriend and I don't have enough time to watch a movie, we throw in stuff like this. So
gotcha.
There's three seasons now, I believe, of Nailed It. So check them out if that sounds like something you would like. Finally on Netflix is High Flying Bird. Speaking of things that sound like porn, this is about a sports agent trying to pitch a rookie basketball client on an intriguing and controversial business opportunity during a lockout. I thought this is interesting because it's directed by Steven Soderbergh and it's a Netflix exclusive.
The Soda Man.
Yeah, he usually does, heist movies and things like that. Mm-hmm. He just recently did Unsane, which I really liked. Last year, it was the iPhone movie with, about the mental hospital situation. Mm-hmm. But yeah, this looks interesting enough that I'm probably going to check that one out as well.
Okay. I don't know. I'll check it out. Maybe we're going to look at a trailer first. I'll take a look. We'll see what I'm thinking.
On Amazon Prime, you have Papillion, the remake that you discussed 5 or 6 episodes ago. You really liked this one. It's about a wrongfully convicted.
I don't think I really liked this one, Frank. I think I was take it or leave it. I was wishy-washy on this one. I think it was done very visually so, but it didn't do the storyline justice, actually. But that's okay that you don't remember anything I say to you.
Dan, we talked about a lot of movies. We've talked about easily over 100 movies already in 12
that's
episodes.
Fair.
But yeah, this one's out February 7th. It's about a man wrongfully convicted for murder. Henry Cherie forms an unlikely relationship with a fellow inmate and a quirky convicted counterfeiter, Luis Diega, in an attempt to escape from the notorious penal colony on Devil's Island. So that's available, take it or leave it, Josh says. And then the longest title of the year. Don't worry, he won't get far on foot.
I wanted to watch this.
Yeah, it's got Jack Black and some other comedians, and it seems a little like
Jonah Hill, right?
Huh?
Jonah Hill's the main dude, right?
No, Joaquin Phoenix is.
Oh.
Yeah.
I thought, is Jonah Hill in this, or am I just fucking throwing out a bunch?
Google it, dude. Stepping all over the plot summary, which is on a rocky path to sobriety after a life-changing accident, John Callahan discovers a healing power of art, willing his injured hands into drawing hilarious, often controversial cartoons, which brings him a new lease on life. The box art, the trailer, looked all too cute for me, but then I remembered Joaquin Phoenix doesn't really do cute stuff. So his involvement is the reason why I'm even considering this one.
Yeah, no, it's the storyline between him and Jonah Hill are discussed a lot. I remember at least they were complimentary, dual characters in this. He wasn't the guy in the wheelchair.
But I might actually check that out if I'm in the mood. I got to be in the mood for those dramas more than
anything. Yeah, check out their sweet, sweet 70s hair that they have in this movie, for sure.
Fucking haircuts, for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Over on Hulu, the season 2 of Legion is out. Have you watched the show, Josh?
I have not.
Okay. Famously, I shitted on this show when this used to be called Bitching About Movies, and then I gave it a second chance, and I love this show.
Oh, wow.
It's created by Noah Hawley, who does the Fargo shows on FX, which I love.
Wow.
I think is the best thing on TV. This is about David Haller. He's a troubled guy who's diagnosed with schizophrenia, but after a strange encounter, he discovers his special powers might change his life and the world forever. It really gets inside the head of this character in creative and inventive ways, unlike anything I've ever seen on TV. And, he constantly struggles with, his abilities. It's very trippy. It's a tough watch at times. It asks a lot out of you. It gets intense. So if that draws you away, maybe it's not for you, but I think it's one of the most interesting and original shows on television, and really something cool and high concept coming out of superhero, a Marvel fucking thing.
Okay.
So that's cool. So I highly recommend Legion. Both seasons are on Hulu. HBO Go, nothing of interest there. VOD rental, a movie that I've seen and loved, Widows, is out. Have you seen Widows, Josh?
Yes, I did.
Yeah, what'd you think of that?
I thought it was a pretty damn good movie. We've been missing out on our want and need for the heist movie and drama and built up fucking characters under tense lines since, honestly, for me, The Town. And I've been waiting for something else to kind of hit that niche that I need.
Yeah, man, this one's super stylized. It gets political. It's got a fucking, drop the – it's like a record scratch, twist towards the end there. And just an amazing cast. Viola Davis, leads the way. But I also like a lot of the actresses that I didn't see much from. Michelle Rodriguez, obviously we know her, but you know, Bailey Rice.
Yeah, Walters, it's, you know, her career befuddles me.
Yeah.
Just Michelle's, you know, kind of like falling off Fast and Furious and Resident Evil, and then just sometimes shows up in these really good movies. It's always, I don't know, her career just kind of has me kind of wondering what the fuck.
I mean, it's just tough when you're a minority, like you're a minority actor, like the roles aren't there. She's not getting the same opportunities. But yeah, she's super talented, and it's a great movie. It's like, as far as just straight up thrilling moments and action, it's up there with anything that came out last year.
Fair enough.
And then also, the Sisters Brothers that I haven't seen yet. I think you were a take it or leave it on this one.
Yeah, and I would say I'd fall more on the take it to see John C. Reilly and Joaquin Phoenix and these other great characters work together. Also, Jake Gyllenhaal's in this. It just felt a little disjointed at times. But go ahead with the summary, Frank.
It's a comedic Western about 1850s Oregon. A gold prospector is chased by the infamous duo of assassins, the Sisters Brothers. I think this is a movie, despite me not seeing it yet, if you watch the trailer, you kind of get an idea if it's for you or not.
Yeah, I will say that comedic is a stretch for sure. I would say this falls more into your Western drama with some light touches, but for the most part, I would say the trailer is a lot more lighthearted than the actual tone of the movie, because there's some pretty bleak and depressing times, and I just felt like they left some storylines wandering and some characters with some ridiculous decisions that you thought would have more recourse. But I think this is still something you could watch, and I'd like to hear your thoughts on for sure.
Yeah, I'm gonna get to it. I think I was trying to wait for it to show up on streaming, but I might just bite the bullet and spend $6 and rent it. It doesn't seem like something I should buy, right? You say, don't buy this, rent it.
You're not going to watch it again, I don't believe.
Word. Okay, man. That actually wraps everything up as far as our what to watch this week and as far as this episode goes. I hope we gave you some ideas and some options to watch. I think we did. We talked about almost 20 movies.
Holy fuck.
And yeah, kind of breezed by. Anything you want to tell the listeners, Josh, before we go?
We're starting a new month. It's a new time for new things. So let's enjoy this one and get those 28 days out of the way.
Cool. Yeah, I'd briefly like to mention, like, hey, our downloads have been like huge the past couple months.
Yeah, if there's one guy named Todd out there that's just fucking downloading this shit a whole bunch of times, I'd love to meet you, Todd. I'd love to buy you maybe like a pizza, pepperoni, you know, let's talk.
We appreciate it. Don't be afraid to engage with us. We're not as scary as we may sound on the podcast. We want to hear from you guys. We're on Twitter, Instagram, I don't know what that was. Instagram, Facebook. Just look for at the Video Store Pod, and you can find us. Thanks for listening, and we'll be back next week. I'll probably watch Lego Movie Part 2 and what's that Cold Pursuit movie, the Liam Neeson movie. So.
Oh, fuck yeah. I need my family back in the snow.
And then we'll be all definitely talking about the standoff at Sparrow Creek. So, you know, that and much more next week. Thanks for listening.
Take care, and folks. You feel that you had quite enough. Just remember that you're standing on a planet that's evolving and revolving at 900 miles an hour. That's orbiting at 19 miles a second, so it's reckoned a sun that is the source of all our power. The sun and you and me and all the stars that we can see are moving at a million miles a day. In an outer spiral arm at 40,000 miles an hour, the galaxy we call the Milky Way. Our galaxy itself contains 100 billion stars. It's 100,000 light years side to side. It bulges in the middle, 16,000 light years thick, but out by us it's just 3,000 light years wide. We're 30,000 light years from galactic central point. We go round every 200 million years. And our galaxy is only one of millions of billions in this amazing and expanding universe.
itself keeps on expanding and expanding in all of the directions it can whiz. As fast as it can go, at the speed of light, you know, 12 million miles a minute, and that's the fastest speed there is. So remember when you're feeling very small and insecure, how amazingly unlikely is your birth. And pray that there was intelligent life somewhere up in space, 'cause there's bugger all over.
Go home. Go.